dying of cancer and you're asking about heart transplant.
Unnecessary scum point.
No, I told him yesterday how much I enjoyed the other piece. And I told him also that it was fascinating. Then he started, as he said, to try to explain it in different terms, as he wanted to say in the music. And I said, there is no need. I didn't say because the music is self-standing. And that is the problem of this. I think composers talk sometimes too much. Because the music is there, that's it. Not to be well played, badly played, and to apologize for the bad performance. I think that this is a very good performance.
Yes.
You're happy with it.
I'm either happy or unhappy.
What?
I'm neither happy nor unhappy.
What do you mean? Why?
I thought it was a little stiff. Tenuous. that's what you have to try, is to write a piano piece for one finger. That was my revenge, so to speak. But I think one of the things that has come, being that I'm a master of ceremonies, one of the things that is a thread of the conversation during the past few days is the whole barrier of style, where I talked about not really understanding or wanting to understand something, or one listens to something or learns something only in relation to its style and not exactly what it is, which I feel is very characteristic, say, of all of my students. They don't understand anything. They begin with style, they don't end with style. And
escape.
In fact, I was surprised to hear it. I forgot that I did it.
So, but nevertheless, it's true. If I had talked this about this time, I said, yes, all of this, I understand.
Yes,
it's his style. Okay, it's trying to stay in the style, and I say, I'm saying no, being down for the
well, that's when I was discussing the young composer's music earlier, this very good young composer was playing a piece of his, and to me, I knew its future, you know, immediately. And I whispered to him, I said, would you mind if we stop now, or would you want us to play it to the end? And he said, it's only 15 minutes. 15 minutes in a seminar was an hour and a half in a concert hall. So, well, a lot of questions are asked, why do you write, why I write long pieces? I never felt that you wrote short pieces. I got involved with this aspect of time when I was running a group in Buffalo, and I started to know it, until that year, probably 78, 79, the whole repertoire was in time. And when you're producing programs, you're very interested in the time, and also when you're paying for programs, you're very interested in what it's going to cost to put on a piece. And what was wonderful about Sinatra's music is that they were very concise and very expensive. which you could say that were true about an envelope, you know. And this whole idea of long and short is, I don't think, the point at all. I think that a lot of people get confused with the point. I don't think it's a question whether it's long or short or concise, as students speak, we prefer to the term. I think one of the problems for me is the social context that you play an hour piece, you see, for a typical audience in Lincoln Center, a big hall in Paris, Amsterdam. That's the problem. So I noticed that the more establishment halls would not play a long piece. They feel that it's out of context to be.
Well, they play the Mahler Symphony second last hours and hours.
Maybe I should change my name.
Ed Mahler.
Are you involved in any way with the context, that is the social context?
The bully to the rest?
Yes.
I
do you think so, that you don't?
No, I don't think so. Never. I should never think like that. special information, imitating things. And imitation, it's like finding the structures that have been produced by generations of people or by civilization and so on. And you could find out very interesting things. Like when you go into the field and you find stones that are interesting, that are all interesting, the stones. And it's something they can tell you something. That is, they go, in the sense, not of language, because many people have said that music is a language. I think that music is not a language. Nothing is a language except the language itself, because there are semantics behind it. But what you can see and understand and grasp, being or not more or interested, is depends on you, on yourself. And this is why I contend that even the most boring piece of the music art, or is like this thing that we see on the wall, has something to, it makes you react in your own personal way. So,
of course.
plants are changing, maybe not so fast as human mind. They change slowly, they see much slower rate, and much slower rate, and they change since we have so many species. And so is the particles also, well, they are changing in the universe. Maybe on a much longer scale of time. We know at least through astrophysics today that the particles are there, some of them are really built like heavier ones. They did not exist at the beginning. The lighter ones, they did not exist at the very, very beginning. There was some kind of soup that was what they imagined today, astrophysicists. So, even in the inertia, the matter itself is changing on a large scale of time. Everything is changing. How do I say that?
Because you're changing.
Yes, so the change of ourselves, like what we are doing, this is a sign of freedom. Freedom, escape of freedom. But we may go on this conscious way. I don't see that it's necessary, it is necessary to escape, but in a memory. Because otherwise you are again just without any link to what it will be exhibited. If there is a wealth of what it will be, or what has been done. Maybe this is why we have history, archaeology, and so on and so forth. The knowledge of oneself is very enriching, very fantastic. But the faculty also to escape from that, knowing what you have been, is also.
Do you think that some memories are better than other memories?
Well, it depends on.
I mean, like a psychoanalysis, one goes there to free oneself of memories that make it impossible to live in reality. And I would say, as a metaphor about becoming a composer, that one has memories that one has to get rid of.
Well, I prefer artistry instead of psychoanalysis, because psychoanalysis is what you do. In fact, you are constructing upon some, say, traces of your memory, something different, a new story. And you think you have lived that story.
You're building another.
You are building something different, and you it becomes like concrete. It is your new past, which you never lived that way. Whereas by doing music, you are doing something like that, it's very different way, and perhaps much more interesting because you are have something to produce. Now, do we need for that to produce something? Whatsoever. Or we don't? Maybe we don't need to.
Do you feel the fact that your work is that you're so consistently productive, which you're closer to perhaps an unconscious vision? I mean, because I don't know anyone besides myself that works like a lunatic as much as you do. I mean a lunatic in a loving way. It's not the psychoanalytic. I mean, because I'm very aware. I'm very aware of you as if it's like the Soviet Union with a missile back. Every way you're writing and you're getting better and better and better, and it's interesting to observe that.
No, I know that I'm
not trying to stop the I'm sure that you're aware of this creative energy through the past.
No, I am aware that I am working very hard because I don't do anything else. So that's the way I know that I'm doing. I don't know if there is any progress. That's different. Progress, the meaning of progress now.
But you see different, you see one sees oneself from, you might essentially do the same thing, but from another angle. Not from a clear linearity, but from a kind of broken linearity.
Yes, like a tree or a lattice.
Do you feel that working the way you do brings you closer to your music? Or does the freedom that you feel comes from arriving at a certain distance from your music?
Well,
I mean, does it position you in a way to continue without being interrupted?
No, the problem is much more simple and complicated at the same time. Which I know the right it is, I am afraid to work by bringing something and limiting myself. Because there is no use in trying to do, say, music like drums.
The reason I talk about this is because talking about it on face value, but I feel it's the key many times. The other key, of course, is to understand just what is imagination, not what is interesting. The whole element of the composer's imagination, in the sense where Xenakis is going, and he's Xenakis, and then he makes that leap, and it's something he's never done and he never heard before. Of course, if you're out on the Empire State Building, like King Kong, you can't get back in the window. But we're not King Kong, so one makes the leap, and then you get back in. And I feel that for young people, you don't put yourself in a position to make that leap. And the reason you don't make that leap is because you don't question what is a composer's imagination and what is the work that has to go on the composer.
Would you take the risk?
Oh, the risk. The risk. I mean, the risk. A kamikaze doesn't take a risk, but he's programmed. When I'm programmed to take risks.
No, the risk, take the risk in comparison to the risk of doing something different in comparison to what you are just doing. You are convinced that it is worthwhile. Suddenly, there is something that looks strange. Now, you can take the risk, do it.
Yes, but you talked about the loud note.
The loud note, yes.
Oh, you like the loud note?
There's nothing.
Oh, I see. I thought you were questioning.
No, no, not at all. It was, it was not a question. It was a trap.
Well, of course, when I do something like that, it kills this linear thinking that we're used to. And if it's all, you see, and all of a sudden it's for half or 45 minutes, it's three T's and there's one note and there are three F's. It stops work for 2 days. I have to think about that. Should I take it in or I take it out? You see, now look what would happen if I would have taken it out. It's a Xenakis.
No question.
But I left it in. But I remember stopping for 2 days and saying, what is it doing here? And maybe the reason is purely, again, both complicated and simple, but maybe I felt that the tension of the piece was such that the loud note was essentially like a balloon, to break the balloon.
What question? Was it loud enough?
Well, Aki, did you feel you played the note, remember? We once discussed how to play a loud note.
Yeah, that was on page 24.
It's page 24, thanks. Could it be loud or not?
44.
How do you feel psychologically where you're playing along all of a sudden without any context? You have to play along.
Yes, present. Yeah, psychologically. I mean, I have to prepare much before that. I have to, you know, keep remember that it's coming. And,
that is not an accident.
No, it should be very disturbing. Because it has to keep on the time.
Until page 24.
Five piano.
Well, yeah, mostly three pianos. Piano, two.
I use a mezzo piano.
Yeah, or strings.
On strings as an attack. It's amazing when they play mezzo piano many times. I had this with the Kronos Quartet when they played my quartets. The mezzo piano became like a sforzando. It's just the muscular release.
It's very difficult to control.
Very difficult to show. I heard that you're using
acoustical result of the amplification, which you don't get. Because you have to then, if you could get that if you have your ears very close to the instruments, or both or three of them, which would be possible. Whereas when you have the amplification, then you can sit there like that and listen to the conglomeration of the sounds. And that is something positive. Otherwise, it was not that interesting. But he tried. Besides the shape of the instrument, they look like string instruments, but the shape, plastic, aesthetically, but not. I could tell you. Not interesting, but nice.
It has that kind of, they should do a fake lacquer, Stradivarius.
Exactly.
I love it. Sometimes I'm more in love with the colors of the cello.
Well, I remember when Max Matthews was tying his violin, all from sound and all from shapes, pre-contact microphones. And I think he improved that. But it's a way perhaps to result, that is to keep the player as usual, but also to get a different sound. Exactly. don't say so. But it's a matter of taste. Now, the third reason that you might use the not only quadratos, but difference, sometimes actually common, is that you produce these beings or these differentiations which might produce some more alive than it is not the case. For instance, when you listen to music from Java, they are tuned in such a way that they look forced to our ears. Why? Because they want that. It's not by chance. It's because they feel that the unison shouldn't be there at all. And these kind of discrepancies are very alive. There's no need to have absolute unison, so to have a very regulated scale like we have here in the West, which is also a tendency, a trend, theoretical and also for practical reasons. So we have the instruments playing together, we need to have the identity of the note pattern, for instance, we have to do that. But this complex in general and deep kind of music, a matter of scales like in rhythm, but we have also probably the same problem of scales. Or intensities, of course, when you have the instruments playing the intensities, the levels, there are very few that you can really play and differentiate. Because our faculty needs big leaps. Unless you constrain yourself by listening to music, and very pedantic, which is another, then you can hear very small, tiny differences. Otherwise, it is lost.
You would notice the score of the trio in a string writing. Where I don't use quarter tones, but I use different spellings. I might have an octave out of tune. And so an E flat, B sharp. I don't like to, and the reason I do it is, I'm ashamed to tell you, I have a very good piano, and I purposely keep it out of tune. And the reason I keep it out of tune is because it's warmer.
I remember that Varese was saying that the conversation we showed there, he pointed out, yes, why do you have here a E flat and then you have a D sharp since you are using 12 tone music? And that was a fact that Varese could show there. Schoenberg said, well, it's not the same thing. It's different. So in spite of the 12-tone music, he accepted the fact, the acoustical fact, that there is a difference.
But I also use it for the same reason that Mr. Zemakis mentioned, to differentiate within small intervals, to get more clarity, say, in a cluster or so. I think of it, again, I use the time Tegnet time. It's like putting Tegnet time, just thin out the Tegnet time.
To close up to a more complex song.
Yes.
Close up to the noise.
It's very, very interesting. Last Sunday I was with an artist friend in New York in the Metropolitan Museum. And we're talking about the late work. I think it was Degas. Turned out, it seemed to be characteristic that as the painting got older and more secure, the more thin he painted, where in his middle age it was this thick, and when he was young, it was a and it's very difficult to paint thinly, because you don't know if it's going to have the same kind of, if it's going to become too flat. That's the problem that I have with too little notes, is that I feel that my music is going to become more or less like a poster. You see, that it's just on the surface. It's not going to have an impasto depth
and dimension.
Yes, that the sound complex itself is not going to have a dimension inward and outward.
Right. This is what happens, as I said, with Java music, but also he sings or sings, and if he doesn't find the opportunity,
I have to tell you a very funny story about the Bible. I was at the festival in New York at Juilliard School of Music. I'm interested in school, so I went around to the various classrooms and I walked into a orchestra rehearsal. And I noticed that the young cellist and the first desk were playing in a lot of vibrato. And in the back desk, the girls and the fellows were younger and they were not playing with too much vibrato. So as this piece, I think it was a Haydn, was the symphony was going, I leaned over and I whispered into the ear of one of the young cellists in the back, why are they using so much vibrato in the first dance? And she says, they're graduating.
Strict on that, although you know that you never obtain that in your orchestra.
except that in temples and the old views, that the temple itself was the genesis of the material. The Beethoven introduction, you know, the Hachigo, you know that it's finally going to evolve into something. And one of the big conscious elements in when I begin a piece is exactly the same thing. It's the kind of material that I begin the piece with suggests in an approximate way its possibilities of continuing. Not because, again, just like Beethoven, the material suggests a kind of very slow variation. So I don't have to think about it. And I avoid, if need be, a material that seems to complete itself in time too completely. I don't think that's the, again, I don't think that the time of the piece is the, important aspect of the piece. Except that I wonder to what degree the pieces will have a sense of living its life, so to speak, if the piece last night was 20 minutes. Because I'm still involved, you know, with an intense selection even now and then. So I wonder what I would intensely select. I'm very much involved with just superficially, not any systematic way, ideas of experience. Just how long does it take for me to experience music? And I found that I remember things in a longer piece much more readily than a piece, for example, that's 25 minutes. But the time is too artificially, I use the word in quotes, constructed. That it's an artifact, the time is used as an artifact. At the same time, I don't like real time. So I'm dangling. Depends if you like the music, it's between heaven and purgatory. Not knowing the Christian hierarchy, where is purgatory in relation to heaven? It's evidently between heaven and heaven. So I'm dangling. If you don't like the music, I'm dangling between purgatory and heaven. But I'm very interested in that equilibrium of keeping it going in times of the saturation of the experience and how much I need in terms of its proportion. What I'm really experiencing is a kind of architecture, really, an inward architecture. And trying to build a bridge over a very long river, wide river. Another 25 minute piece. So Elliot Carter. about it. I said, you mean like my pieces? This is a true story. And then I kind of covered up with the host. And the next day on the phone, I had a call from Steve Reich. And it was a festival. We were going to do something for Steve Reich. So I said, I feel very bad. I said, I had a dinner party for Elliot Carter. And I said to him, what the world doesn't need is another 25-minute piece. And he says, you mean my life? Finally, I got a phone call about a week later from a composer I don't think you know here. We studied together with the same teacher. His name is Ralph Shapey. And he had a piece for solo piano. And he said, can I have a piece for piano four hands instead? I said, great. We have a marvelous two-piano husband and wife team. And there'll be no problem. I said, how long is it? 23, 25 minutes? And there was a silence. This was a phone call from Chicago. A long silence. And he said, how did you know? So I think it's just too ingrained, you know. At the time of the century, a half an hour, as I mentioned earlier, you know, that was a masterpiece. I think the Rites of Spring comes in on 26 minutes.
Changes, but the changes are sort of avoiding the point of the piece, or they're, you know what I mean? That they're just changes, then they're artificial.
No.
You're not really getting deeper into whatever this abstract experience is.
No, it's not in that sense. It's in the sense that when you're writing, let's say, sequence, there is something that is slightly different, and that could lead you to something much more important.
Okay, so when you don't mean a big style change, you just mean a different angle or some new problem comes in.
In the your own architecture, there is something slightly different, as it is, as it happens to be, and if you can grasp it as a difference that could lead. Then that becomes the